wanted to take a quick survey first. How many of you have actually shopped from Zappos before? Oh, wow, very cool. Well, thank you. So normally when I do this survey, the ratio is actually about 2 to 1 women to men. And a lot of guys I ask say they actually haven't personally shopped from us, but their wives or significant others have. And a lot of times it's actually on their behalf. And a few years ago, I was giving a tour to an executive from one of the major record labels. And, and by the way, we're actually located in downtown Las Vegas. And next time you're in Vegas, we would encourage you to come for a tour. We offer them Monday through Fridays. It takes about an hour. And so this was actually at our previous office in Henderson. We just moved offices right about a year ago. And I asked him the exact same question. Had he shopped from us before? And he said, no, he hadn't personally shopped from us, but he suspected his wife had, because these white boxes would show up on his doorstep, and then they just disappear, and he'd have no idea what was going on. He didn't know if she was exchanging shoes, returning shoes, buying more shoes. And every time he asked her what was going on, she would flat out refuse to answer him and change the topic. So at the time, we were actually spread amongst 3 different buildings. And in the building I was in, I sat in this area known as our merchandising team. And so we walked through, and then we go upstairs to our customer loyalty team, which is our name for our call center. And you'll see when you come on the tour, we have this whiteboard that lists the different stats, like number of phone calls we took yesterday, percent we answered in 20 seconds or less, and sales through the call center, and so on. And as I'm stepping through these stats, I turn around and he's disappeared. And I'm like, oh, that's kind of weird. So I go looking for him, and then finally I find him. Turns out he had gone halfway down one of our aisles, sat down next to one of our customer service reps, and forced her to pull up his wife's account. And he discovered that she had spent over $62,000 in her lifetime. So hopefully we weren't instrumental to any divorce proceedings or anything like that. So most people, when they think Zappos, they think shoes, because that's how we started. But internally, we actually have a saying that we're a service company that just happens to sell shoes. And our hope is 10 years from now, people won't even realize we started selling shoes online. And in fact, today we sell a lot more than shoes. We sell clothing and handbags and other product categories. But really, we just want to build the brand to be about the very best customer service and customer experience. And so we've talked about how one day there could be a Zappos Airlines or a Zappos Hotel that's just about delivering the very best customer service. And so our whole philosophy is to take most of the money we would have normally spent in paid advertising and paid marketing, and rather invest it in that, invest it into the customer experience and customer service, and then let our customers do the marketing for us through word of mouth. And so we've grown from no sales in 1999 to 2008 was the first year we hit $1 billion in gross merchandise sales. We're actually doing about triple that now. And the number one driver of all that growth has been through repeat customers and word of mouth. And so for all of this focus on customer service, the number one priority of the company is actually not customer service. Our number one priority is company culture. And our whole belief is that if we get the culture right, that most of the other stuff like delivering great customer service or building a long-term enduring brand or business will just be a natural byproduct of that. And so internally, we have something that we refer to as the 3 C's in terms of how we think of our brand: clothing, customer service, and company culture. And really, this is kind of representative of the life cycle of the customers. They learn that we have a great selection of clothing and footwear and other product categories. Then they experience our customer service, whether it's by calling our call center or by seeing how easy the free shipping and free returns is, or how quickly we ship the product. And then ultimately they learn about our company culture and our core values, because that's the platform that makes everything possible. So whether it's the happiness that customers feel from getting that perfect pair of shoes or perfect outfit, or the happiness that customers feel from experiencing great customer service, or the happiness that employees feel from being part of a culture where the values of the company match their own personal values, the thing we realize ties these 3 C's together is that Zappos is really just about delivering happiness, whether it's to customers or employees, and we try to apply that same philosophy to our vendor partners as well. And so one of my favorite quotes, and this is something actually I think is just a really good thing to think about no matter what business you're in, and I forget who said this, but is a great brand is a story that never stops unfolding. And that's not something that we've consciously thought of over the years at Zappos. This was just kind of this organic evolution. We went from wanting to just sell a lot of shoes to really building the brand to be about customer service, and then we added on company culture. And so when the book came out, we said, okay, delivering happiness, we get it. And the question I got asked a lot back in 2010 was, well, what's next? And for the longest time, we actually didn't have a great answer. This is actually what our Henderson, or the building I was in, we were spread amongst three different buildings, and when we first moved to, we actually moved to Vegas from San Francisco, and at the time, this was over 10 years ago now, we had about 90 employees in San Francisco, about 70 moved with the company to Vegas, to Henderson, and we grew over the years. We're actually at about 1,500 employees now. And as we grew, we needed more buildings, and that what we found was that having multiple buildings actually had a real impact on our culture. And so we were trying to find a place where we could house everyone under one roof and have enough land to expand upon. And we found out a few years ago that the city of Las Vegas was actually building a new city hall, and this is now the former city hall that was going to become available. And it was in an area of downtown Vegas that actually most people had not heard about or even been. And so this was actually our ribbon cutting from last year. We actually set a new world record. We had a ribbon that was over a mile long, and then had the record was most number of people simultaneously cutting a ribbon. We had 1,500 people. And then someone decided it would be a good idea afterwards to have a happy hour with 1,500 pairs of scissors running around. It was fine. So rewind 3 years before this whole move-in thing, we were trying to figure out, okay, what do we want in our dream campus? And I just emailed out our employees and said, what amenities would you like? And literally got back hundreds and hundreds of responses. And then I went in, along with some other folks, toured some amazing corporate campuses like Apple, Nike, Google. I remember at Nike, there was this one building where there was a running track around it, and then they had another building that had an on-site pub, and we thought to ourselves, we need one of those. And so those were some of the suggestions employees gave. They wanted an on-site gym and an on-site pub. But the number one request we got from employees was actually doggy daycare. More than human daycare, but. And so we got hundreds of requests, and then we realized a couple things. One was that it was just gonna be physically impossible to fit all those amenities into the space we had. But the other thing we realized was that all those other campuses, Apple, Nike, Google, were great for employees, but were actually really kind of insular and didn't really integrate or contribute to the community around them. And so we thought to ourselves, what if we turned the entire concept inside out? What if instead of just focusing on ourselves, we took an approach that was more analogous to NYU, where the campus kind of blends in with the city, and you don't really know where one begins and the other ends? What if we actually encourage our employees to leave campus and walk around and interact with the community, and we actually encourage people from the community to come into our campus? And so this was a few years ago, right about the same time, a bunch of Zappos employees, myself included, discovered this whole, not new, but new to us, whole new area of downtown Vegas that most tourists, and I'd say actually even a lot of locals don't know about, called Fremont East. And most people, when they think Las Vegas, they think about the strip, like the casino we're in now, which, as it turns out, is technically not even within the city limits of Las Vegas. Or if they know anything about downtown Vegas, it's the old casinos, it's the overhead light show. But if you actually just go a few blocks east of that, there's this area called Fremont East where you would have no idea you're in Vegas. There's no gaming in the different bars and restaurants there. And if anything, it's almost like the complete opposite of the strip and the Vegas that most people know. And so, and the whole vibe there is actually, I grew up in San Francisco. It's actually the most community-focused place I've ever lived. I've never lived in a place where the bar owners and restaurant owners and cafe owners hang out in each other's places just to support the community. And so it was a perfect fit for our culture at Zappos, and it was only a few blocks away from the former City Hall. So it just seemed like it was one of those things that was almost too good to be true. And so for us, the answer just kind of came to us. We decided in terms of our brand to add a fourth C, and that fourth C being community. And so now we try to weave all four of these C's into the different customer touch points at Zappos. And so for example, a couple months ago, we had a skateboarding event where we shut down a couple blocks in downtown Vegas in the Fremont East area, built skating ramps, had skateboarders that were competing. It was free to the community. We had employees that came, and so they get to bond and that helped build company culture. And then that video of that was available to our customers that were interested in buying skating shoes. And so through that process, we kind of get to weave in the story of Zappos employees and culture and what's going on with the downtown Vegas community. And so that's the Zappos side of things. Now I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about Downtown Project, which is actually a separate company, privately funded by myself and a few other friends. And it's really meant to help complement the Zappos move and really help accelerate our revitalization efforts in this area of downtown Vegas. And so it has a $350 million budget, and there's a few different goals. One is to help create a place where you have everything you need to live, work, play within walking distance. Another one is to help make downtown Vegas the most community-focused large city in the world, and probably the place most people would least expect it. And then to help make it the co-learning and co-working capital of the world. And in terms of co-working spaces, I'm not just talking about tech co-working spaces, but also fashion co-working spaces and culinary co-working spaces and maker spaces and so on. And what I come from the tech world, and so when you talk about tech communities, there's online tech communities, offline tech communities. And one of our lessons over the years is that actually when you're talking about physical neighborhoods, there's a very, very different set of expectations and preconceptions about what community should mean. So we actually decided to make it be very specific about what we're trying to do. We have our own separate three C's at Downtown Project: collisions, co-learning, and connectedness. And by collisions, we mean people in public or semi-public places unexpectedly colliding with each other, having these serendipitous interactions. And that's something that we want to try to maximize. Co-learning, meaning having the community learn from itself, as well as from visitors that are coming in. And connectedness, meaning the number and depth of relationships. And then combining that with this concept of density and diversity. And the reason why all of these are important is ultimately it just comes down to how do we become more productive? How do we become more innovative as a community? And therefore for every participant in the community, including Zappos as a company. Because the research has shown that most innovation actually comes from something outside your industry being applied to your own. And so the big bet is by focusing on these three C's, collisions, co-learning, and connectedness, not only will that lead to a happier and luckier community, but actually innovation and productivity increases. And unlike a lot of other real estate developers, instead of that have these short or medium-term ROI or cash flow needs, we're really focusing on maximizing the long-term ROC, return on community and return on collisions. And then also there's this acronym I stole from Jim Collins' latest book, Great by Choice, ROL, where we're actually trying to increase the return on luck. And really think about how do we accelerate serendipity. And so, which seems like a weird thing to try to manage, like how do you actually manage luck? But we actually have very real metrics associated with it, and I'll share that a little bit later on. And so I'll do a quick breakdown of the budget, how it's allocated. So first, we've set aside $50 million to invest in small businesses to help make it a walkable neighborhood, to help build a sense of neighborhood and community. And so this is actually my wall in my apartment. And for the first 2 years of the project, we had literally tours were going through my apartment. And we would just ask people, what do you want in your dream neighborhood? You know, a lot of development projects are kind of top-down master planned. And we really wanted this to be much more organic, much more actually entrepreneur-driven. And so if it wasn't already on the wall, we'd encourage people to write it down, put it on the wall. But the other cool thing that would happen is every once in a while, we'd get someone whose lifelong dream was to say, retire 10 years from now and start a cupcake bakery. And we just say, well, rather than wait 10 years, why don't you start it now? And we'll fund it and help support you along the way, and you can start living your dream, and it'll help out the neighborhood and the community. And so we have a bunch of different criteria. Owner-operated is really important, and it needs to be something that really helps promote collisions and people getting together, and the entrepreneur needs to care more about just herself, but also needs to care about and care more about just her business. She needs to care about other entrepreneurs and helping other local businesses. Unique, first or best is really important to us. We've had a lot of people come and say, oh, there's this great restaurant concept or chain that I've seen in 7 other cities, and you should open one up here too. And we generally say no to those because we want to have our own identity, and we don't want to be the eighth. And story worthy is really important to us. So this is Natalie, who I serendipitously ran into at the local coffee shop a couple years ago, maybe 2.5 years ago. And turns out she had worked for 10 years as a chef in one of the casinos and had actually just quit her job because she was sick of working in a casino environment and had packed up her bags and was ready to move back home to Santa Fe. And as we were talking, we learned that her lifelong dream was to open up her own breakfast and lunch place. So through a bunch of other serendipitous interactions, she met other people. She met a guy named Don from our team, and they met while on the street corner. Both were happened to be walking their dogs together, and they ran into each other. And she became one of the first small businesses that we funded. And so you can see this her place under construction. And oh, by the way, I'm not really a PowerPoint person, but I'm very proud of this transition, so we're gonna watch it again. So you see how it just appears around her? So thank you. This was under construction, and she opened up about 1 year and 8 months ago. And the reason that I know that it was 1 year and 8 months ago is because at the 1 year and 3 month mark, she paid back her entire initial investment. And she's doing, I think, triple her initial projections. And it's become this new daytime community hub. If you go in there for breakfast or lunch, chances are you're going to run into 5 or 10 people you know during that hour that you're eating. And now she's thinking about what should she do as a second restaurant concept. And she's also been mentoring other restaurant entrepreneurs, first-time restaurant entrepreneurs in the local neighborhood. This was a check cashing place a couple years ago. And this is Sarah, whose lifelong dream was to open up her own boutique clothing store. And so this was another one of our early investments. And she calls it a hangout place that just happens to sell clothing. And people in the community stop by several times a day. Some people will work out of there. Sometimes after hours, there'll be a DJ there. And people just stop in, so it's another place for these collisions. We actually open what I think is the world's largest shipping container park, and if any of you have a chance, it's open 7 days a week. Would encourage you to come there. That's actually a 40-foot praying mantis from Burning Man that shoots out 20-foot flames starting at right around sunset. And then inside, in the middle, there's this kid's, because a couple years ago, it was pretty much impossible to find kids or family around this area of downtown. And we wanted to create a place that was really family friendly. And so there's a giant slide and other kids' activities in the middle. But we wanted a vibe like a backyard barbecue vibe where the kids are having fun, the adults are having fun. And so in this case, there's different bars and restaurants. So the adults can enjoy their wine and cheese, listen to their live music, hang out with their adults friends while they know that the kids are safe and having fun. And in addition to that, this is also a small business incubator. So we actually have about 40 small businesses, business retailers. Most of them, this is actually their first attempt at a small business, but they're all on short-term leases. And so it enables them to, it could be as little as 3 months, where if they have an idea, they can try it out, and then if it doesn't work out, then they can try another idea, and it's pretty low risk. So these are just some slides of one example where it was their first retail project. This is actually a guy named Ernie who used to be a Zappos call center rep several years ago, and then he left Zappos because he wanted to pursue his passion for barbecue. And so he was making barbecue sauce, cooking meat, and then going to farmers markets and selling them. And we knew him from his Zappos days. And we also saw how passionate he was about what he was doing. So we actually decided to invest in him as well. And literally a year and a half ago, he was on the sidewalk selling his barbecue food for, I think, taking in maybe $100 a day in top line revenue. And that's, I just happened to be walking by. I took this picture with my iPhone this was about a year ago. And that's literally his restaurant being lowered down behind him. And now he's doing something like $150K a month, has 15 employees, and living his passion. So it's just pretty exciting to hear and experience stories like that. We opened up a health clinic that's actually focused on primary and preventative care. So it's like a gym member type of thing where you pay $80 a month and they're actually focused on trying to keep you healthy, and we'll check in with you daily if necessary to see if you're keeping up with your exercising, or there's free yoga and so on. And so it's really focused more on healthcare than sick care. We have $50 million set aside for tech startup companies, and in the past year, we've probably relocated about 60 tech companies to downtown Vegas from other cities, or even countries, actually. We had a 20-person company from China that was actually originally going to Silicon Valley and then decided to move here. And so a few years ago, there was really no tech scene, and now it's really gotten to a critical mass. So there's different co-working spaces. And this is actually a company that just officially launched today, actually. The code word for it was Project 100, and it's been renamed Shift. But basically, we placed the largest order of Teslas in the US, ordered 100 Teslas, along with other electric bikes or electric cars and also regular bikes. And the idea is launching this car sharing, bike sharing program that you can learn more about. And these are some of the co-working spaces. Some were set up initially as co-working spaces, and some were just accidental co-working spaces, like this casino that we took over. It used to be this old smoky casino, and then it got renovated, and by nighttime, it's a cool hangout place. There's live music in the backyard on weekends, but during the daytime, sometimes I go in there, and there's laptops all around the bar, and there's no place to sit. And it's used for a lot of different events that downtown as well. This is a picture of the backyard. And so I'll just flip through some of these slides. And so we asked these companies why Vegas? Why do they want to move to downtown Vegas? And we get two answers. One is really the sense of community that I was initially talking about in as it applied to the small businesses like the restaurants, bars, and so on. But they found that actually it's the same thing here, where the tech companies all want to help each other out, and that's kind of their default bias. And then the other reason why they say downtown Vegas is appealing is because it's really this whole idea of thinking of the city as a startup. And how many opportunities do you have in a lifetime to help shape the future of a major city? We've separately set aside $50 million to invest in education, arts, and music. And so we opened up an early childhood center that's actually starting at 6 weeks, teaching kids entrepreneurship and creativity using the latest neuroscience research. There's a festival called First Friday that draws 20 to 25,000 people each month. And then we're also bringing Burning Man art to downtown Vegas. And so I think you can actually crawl up in there, and that's 80 feet tall or something, and put a DJ on top. And so the idea is every block or so, put some sort of large-scale art, put some sort of fire element, and just essentially trick people into walking one more block and one more block and then one more block. Because here in Vegas, it's a very car-focused town and culture. Life is Beautiful is a festival that we threw for the first time last October, and it's actually coming up in, I think, 5 or 6 weeks. And we fenced off 15 city blocks, which has never been done before in any city. And it was actually 4 festivals in 1. It was a music festival, 65 bands. So we had The Killers, Imagine Dragons, Kings of Leon, Beck, and so on. It was its own culinary festival, 50 celebrity chefs, its own art festival. We had 16 murals go up. And the cool thing is, most of those murals are still up even after the festival, so it helped beautify the city. And then its own speaking festival. So we had different speakers from all different backgrounds give TED-like talks. And so I actually have a video to show. And this video was actually put together by Downtown Films, which was one of our other small business investments. And I really like this video because a lot of videos that I've seen are very kind of slick and glossy, and they make the event seem much better than it actually was. Whereas this video, every time I see it, it just brings me back to what the feeling, the vibe of what it was like, because I think they did a really good job of really capturing it. So let's play the video.
We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams.
Lost my
So, thank you. So last year we had 60,000 people come over 2 days, and the cool thing was, for most of those people, it was their first time ever being in that area of downtown Vegas, and they'd walk into the local coffee shop and realize that this wasn't just some pop-up tent, but it was a real coffee shop in real life as well. And so we heard back from the small businesses in the weeks after that their business was up as people went back to experience that area of town in real life as well. This is a super interesting book. Even if you're not involved in city revitalization stuff, it's called Triumph of the City. And it's written by a Harvard economics professor that studied cities from all different time periods, like Rome, New York, Detroit, and looked at why some thrived and some didn't. And a lot of his findings are actually really counterintuitive, but they're actually what's guiding our efforts in downtown Vegas. And one of the most interesting findings that he cites is that every time the size of a city doubles, innovation or productivity per resident increases by 15%. But the opposite happens with companies. Generally, as companies get bigger, innovation or productivity per employee goes down. And so from the Zappos perspective, part of why we're interested in really participating in this really city concept is trying to prevent that fate. How do we actually have Zappos be organized and function more like a city and less like a big bureaucracy that you find as companies get bigger? And so the ingredients for that to happen are, you need a residential density of 100 residents per acre, combined with street level activity, so for those residents to collide, so all those post-it notes you saw earlier. And the third is probably the hardest, but it's also the cheapest and the one that gives you the most leverage, just having this culture of openness, collaboration, and sharing. And I think of this as almost a multiplier. So maybe if people are twice as likely to talk to each other, then you only need half that residential density. And it turns out that over the past 15 years at Zappos, we've done a lot of thinking and experimentation about thinking about how do we get employees to collide with each other in an office environment. And we think about things like average office density in the US is 200 or 300 square feet per employee. And then at Zappos, we were at 120 while we were in Henderson, and then now we're down to about 100. And the reason why that's so important to us is because the research has shown that if you sit twice as far away from someone in an office environment, you don't see them half as often. You see them half as often squared, so a quarter as often. And we just do weird things where we prioritize collisions over convenience. And so off to the left there, off the screen, is where the parking garage is. And the city employees used to park there and then just go through the Skybridge and wind up inside the office. And we actually decided to shut down that Skybridge, which then forces employees out onto the sidewalks, and there's more collision opportunities with each other as well as with the community. And so the big bet, and this is just a partial list now, is get all these different groups from diverse backgrounds that are creative, entrepreneurial, and have a bias to collaborate and be helpful with each other. Get them together in a relatively small space, and statistically, the magic will just kind of happen on its own. This is the Ogden, which is where I live right now, and we're actually in the middle of transitioning, when we first started this project, we actually had high as 100 furnished apartments that we set up as free hotel rooms, and now we're actually turning some of our other properties, moving those hotel rooms over there. But basically, anytime we meet someone, we just say, hey, next time you're in Vegas, come stay in one of our furnished apartments, a free hotel room. And that basically tricks them into discovering the local neighborhood, the local coffee shops, the local bars, and so on. And then out of those 100 people that sometimes we host in a week, we'll just ask 20 of them, hey, as long as you're in town, do you want to give a talk about whatever you're passionate about? And 95% of the time, they say yes. And so then it becomes this free ongoing content for the community, plays into that co-learning aspect of things. And so just imagine if Wednesday afternoon through Sunday afternoon, you can walk into a place and there's someone giving a TED-like talk about something. And so we actually decided to build that place, and right at the corner of Fremont and Las Vegas Boulevard, you know, probably the most prominent intersection of all, in all of Las Vegas, rather than turn it into a bar or a fast food place, we decided to turn it into a speaker's lounge and stage called Inspire Theater. So this, it's actually open now, and there's different elements to it. There's also different co-working spaces and coffee shops and rooftop bar and so on. And so we've started theming each of the different weeks, and so looks like so you can see second week of every month is tech focus, third week is fashion focus, and so on. And when we started this project, because of that 100 residents per acre thing was stuck in our heads, we thought we either had to build a lot of high rises or convince people to live in really small spaces, because that was the only way that we could mathematically think of how do you get to 100 residents per acre. And then start doing the math on someone, say, like me. What is the actual value of a resident? Well, it's when they're out and about in the community. So someone like me, I'm probably out and about in the community, call it 3 or 4 hours a day in a collisional way, so public or semi-public place like a bar, restaurant, cafe, and so on. 7 days a week, I travel a lot, 40 weeks a year. Do the math, it works out to about 1,000 collisional hours a year for a resident like me. And then there's this guy named Jake who lives in New York, and we met maybe a couple years ago. And at the time, he had the most successful fashion-related Kickstarter campaign, raised almost $300,000 on Kickstarter. And for those of you who may not know what Kickstarter is, basically you put together a 3 or 4 minute video and with your project idea, and then people might decide to pay $25 or $100 to participate in that project. And he actually since then has broken that record. He just raised a few months ago over $1 million on Kickstarter. And so we said, you should move to downtown Vegas. There's this emerging fashion community and tech community, and you're kind of at the intersection of both of them. And for various reasons, he couldn't. But he committed to coming to downtown Vegas once a month during that fashion focus week and participate in the community, contribute to the community by having office hours and mentoring other entrepreneurs and giving talks. One of his talks was how to do a really good Kickstarter campaign, which was helpful to other entrepreneurs. And so sometimes he hangs out in Stitch Factory, which is one of the fashion incubators we invested in. And so we started doing the math on someone like Jake. What is the value of a purposeful visitor that even though technically he doesn't live here, he still contributes to the community, and now when he walks around, people recognize him. And so he has become part of the community, even though he doesn't live here. And so when he's here, he's out in about 12 hours a day, times 7 days a week, 12 times a year. It actually works out to about 1,000 collisional hours a year. So while we still want people to move to downtown Vegas, we now have this kind of cool layer of people like Jake, purposeful visitors, where they can also participate in the idea sharing and flow, and then it can really help accelerate everything. And we've been calling people like Jake subscribers of downtown Vegas. So we basically took that formula of 100 residents per acre and modified it so that instead of that, what we realized we really care about is having 100,000 collisional community hours per acre per year, which works out to 2.3 collisional hours per square foot per year, which just gives us a whole new lens through which to think about all our investments. And so if it's a restaurant, then in addition to it being a good restaurant investment, we do the math on how many customers, how long they'll be there, what's the square footage, and make sure that it yields at least this much. And so the big bet is by focusing on these three C's, collisions, co-learning, connectedness, what we want people to say about downtown, whether they're just visiting for the first time and happen to be walking to one of the free talks that from one of the visitors, or they're subscribers, or they live there, what we want people to say about downtown is that downtown Vegas will make you smarter, which is probably the last thing that most people would associate with downtown or Las Vegas. So I'm involved with a few different companies. There's Zappos, there's Delivering Happiness, which was a company that was spun off of my book and has its own separate CEO. And they're based out of the Bay Area, and they're focused on helping companies develop their own strong cultures and downtown projects. And so there's kind of this common theme of inspiration that we try to weave throughout the different companies. And I don't think a lot of people know this, actually, but we just passed a major threshold in human history where for the first time ever in the entire history of humanity, for the first time ever, 50% of all humans now live in cities. And it seems kind of crazy, but within our lifetime, that number is actually going to jump up to 75%. And so we view what we're doing at Downtown Project as much more than just about downtown Vegas or the Vegas area in general. We're actually kind of inspired by the story of the 4-minute mile, where for those of you who may not know it, for the longest time, people thought it was impossible to run a mile in under 4 minutes. Or they thought even if you did, you'd probably collapse and die as soon as you pass the finish line or something. And then in 1954, this guy named Roger Bannister broke the 4-minute mile. But what I find super interesting is that in less than a year, other people broke the 4-minute mile. So it wasn't that nutrition was better on Earth that year, it's just that people believed it was possible. And so, you know, a lot of city revitalization projects depend on having inexpensive sports team or stadium or a Harvard or Stanford, and not every community or city can afford those things. And so we purposely chose those three C's of collisions, co-learning, and connectedness because we wanted something that could be replicated to other communities and cities. And if we can help make downtown Vegas, a place probably voted by many as least likely to succeed, if we can help make downtown Vegas a place of inspiration and entrepreneurial energy and creativity and upward mobility and innovation and all that good stuff, if we can help make that happen here, then maybe downtown Vegas can serve as the 4-minute mile for the world and help inspire other communities and cities to reinvent themselves. So if you'd like a copy of this presentation, feel free to email me, tony@zappos.com. And then I just wanted to end on that quote that I would really think about for your company or whatever you're involved in, that a great brand is a story that never stops unfolding. And I think the same is true for a company, the same is true for a city, and the same is true for a community. And that is why I'm personally just so excited to be a resident of downtown Las Vegas right now, because I can't wait to see what unfolds next. Thank you very much.